Corporal Christiana Halsey.
And I'm Chief Petty Officer Herb Josie. This week on Navy Marine Corps News, chiefs around the fleet get a ship they can call their own.
Marines in Guantanamo Bay stand guard as caretakers.
And sailors in Japan spend life at sea aboard tugboats. Join us for these stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News. This week on Navy Marine Corps News, chiefs around the fleet get a ship they can call their own. Marines in Guantanamo Bay stand guard as caretakers, and sailors in Japan spend life at sea aboard tugboats. Join us for these stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News.
Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Corporal Christiana Halsey.
And I'm Chief Petty Officer Herb Josie. Chief Petty Officers from around the fleet gathered in Norfolk to witness the commissioning of a ship that has a special meaning to their community.
No matter where this ship goes, that will every Chief Petty Officer in the Navy will say, that's my ship.
This is a great day for the Navy right here. I'm very proud to be here.
And come they did, by the thousands, Chief Petty Officers, former Chief Petty Officers from all over the world. They came together at Little Creek Amphibious Base to see the ship named in their honor come to life. This day was for chiefs and by chiefs. The band, all chiefs. The color guard, all chiefs. Even the side boys, chiefs. Outside the commissioning tent, chiefs lined up to buy USS Chief souvenirs and mementos.
Take care of that fleet out there, I tell you.
And up and down the pier, chiefs got caught up in the emotion and camaraderie of this day.
This is the first one I have seen since 1946, and I had goosebumps when they commissioned it.
We're the backbone of the Navy, so the name ship means a lot to me.
And the day meant a lot for the crew, especially EN3 Randy Marquez, whose grandfather came to see the ship commissioned.
Because I know it'd mean a lot to him to be here, so that makes me happy that he's here.
I'm real proud of all the men on that ship.
You see, his grandfather served on the original USS Chief back in World War II, and has plenty of stories to tell his grandson about sailing on a minesweeper.
Take advantage of all the schools, the training they can get.
This is truly a special and historic day for Chief Petty Officers, those who have served, those now serving, and those who will serve after us.
Some have suggested that the ship takes on the qualities of the crew or the sponsor. My hope is that she will take on the very best qualities of the Chief Petty Officer.
Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Mike Porter praised those qualities, which chiefs have used throughout the years to make other people successful, especially in his case.
My chief, George Everding. George, please stand so everyone here can applaud a Chief Petty Officer who not only cared about his people, but a Chief Petty Officer who went more than the extra mile to make a difference.
The CNO met his chief after the ceremony. This was the person who, years ago, got then PN1 Borda to sign up for the Seaman to Admiral program, and you know the rest of the story. The minesweeper is small and has a small crew, but USS Chief will sail with something larger than the ship and crew, the spirit of all Chief Petty Officers in the Navy, past, present, and future. By the way, this is the last Avenger-class minesweeper to be built. And you know, Chris, one chief came from as far away as Japan, another from Naples, and one from Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, just to be a part of this ceremony.
And of course, the Navy Marine Corps mission is still in the news in Guantanamo Bay. Sailors and Marines are still working day and night to meet the needs of thousands of migrants that populate the camps.
And they're also helping to improve the migrants' quality of life as well. In part two of our series on these caretakers, Petty Officer Bill Miles tells us about Marines who are showing how they care.
Over 1,000 Marines are providing external security for most of the Cuban migrant camps here in Guantanamo Bay. The largest contributor of these caretakers, about 800, are from 1st Battalion, 2nd Marines out of Camp Lejeune.
Our mission is external security of the wire to make sure the migrants are safe from any danger of the wire, for example, them trying to go over the wire.
They not only patrol around the camps.
Rover 4 is guard check.
They also keep watch from guard towers.
What we do is we look for things like black marketing, little things being passed back and forth from one camp to another, and watching for migrants trying to escape.
A few migrants do escape. There are just not enough Marines to keep the tens of thousands of Cubans in the camps. Some are just trying to get back to Cuba without waiting for proper channels. They either climb down these cliffs and try to swim to Cuba, or they head for the hills.
What they do is break out the camps and they try to find a road, one like this, or the high tops down here. Well, they try to stay high so they can see if anybody's coming after them.
It's the job of Marines like these, members of an observation or listening post, that patrol and look for migrants that have walked away from their camps. They return most of the Cubans wandering these hills, but not all are caught.
What they do is they go across the ridge line over to the high top, and they try to get over and across. You see a fire out there, there's a little tower. That's the closest Cuban tower, right out here.
Marines tell me that the best security isn't patrolling around the camps, but it's getting together with the Cubans and participating in events like this.
Malafroy! I think they like it a lot. I think it gives them something more to do than they have in camp. And it's important for them to see that we care about them, because we do.
Siento muy bien, la verdad. No tenemos ningún tipo de problema entre los cubanos y los marines.
He feels very good about running with us. He doesn't have, the Cubans and the Marines don't have any problems, and this is the best thing for them.
While running is probably the most popular activity between Cubans and Marines, they also play softball and basketball. These activities help bring Marines and migrants together to see each other as real people.
As you know, we deal with external security, and we don't see these people on the outside. Now, once we get together with them, we see how they are. We can communicate, in other words, and it becomes a better life for both of us. We understand them even more.
Besides sports, Marines are also helping out in other ways, like providing a wheelchair for this handicapped Cuban.
Just try it out.
And it gives you a good feeling inside that you're really, really helping people, and you get to see it hands-on. You know, you don't see it from just one point of view. You get to see it right up close, up front, and to see that your individual actions can help an individual person.
Marines, not just providing security, but showing the kind of caretakers they truly are. Petty Officer Bill Miles, Guantanamo Bay, Cuba.
Marines aren't the only ones helping migrants in Gitmo. Navy chaplains are also making life better in the camps. And next week in part three of our series, Petty Officer Miles will tell us about these caretakers.
September's evacuation of family members from Gitmo left the base's DoD schools closed, and Joint Task Force 160 is using the school facilities as office spaces and chow halls. But the well-equipped playgrounds that were once filled with happy children were empty. That is until a group of base residents formed a volunteer group to bring children back to the playgrounds. Petty Officer Michael Dean Gold reports from Gitmo.
This is one of dozens of camps in Gitmo that are temporary home to tens of thousands of Cuban and Haitian migrants. Within the camps are more than 2,000 children of all ages, children like 11-year-old Saley Diaz. In front of her is the concertina wire fence that separates her camp from the naval station. This is what Gitmo looked like to Saley and the other children. That all changed when a group of active duty Navy personnel stationed in Gitmo had an idea to bring these kids to the school playgrounds. It's called Operation Love the Children, and because of this program, Saley and hundreds of children in these camps are seeing a different Gitmo. Operation Love the Children is a volunteer program providing field trips to Cuban and Haitian children in Gitmo. Buses take the children and their camp chaperones to the elementary school playground 6 days a week. Love the Children volunteers greet the children at the school. The primary function of volunteers is to make sure the children are safe, their needs are taken care of, and they enjoy their afternoon at the playground. For the volunteers, the rest of the time is spent playing with the kids.
And that's good for them today, man, you know. I hope everything going like this, you know what I'm saying?
The volunteers come from base residents and personnel within the Joint Task Force. Although the program was designed for the children, for many volunteers, interacting with these kids helps them deal with their stressful jobs and separation from their own families.
Our dependents were taken off the base just a little over a month ago, and so we have a chance to come out and do something with children since ours are no longer here.
I feel that this is making a positive impact on the children because we're making a bad situation better.
These children have been through some very scary times over the past few months. Operation Love the Children allows them to get out of the camps and just be kids for a while. For the volunteers who come out, it's a chance to relax, show they care, and love the children. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Michael Dean Gold, Guantanamo Bay, Cuba.
You know, it's great to see the kids getting out and being able to play.
Mm-hmm. It's nice for them to be kids again for a change. They're really able to do that and get from behind that barbed wire. When we return, we'll take you back to where it all begins, Recruit Training Command in Great Lakes.
And inner city youth learn what it takes to be young Marines. Don't go away.
During World War II, millions of American men and women joined the armed forces. To win the war, a massive industrial effort was needed, and America's women answered the call. Mothers, daughters, sisters, and wives worked in shipyards, aircraft plants, and munitions factories. Rosie the Riveter and 17 million like her helped win the war. I'm June Allison. A grateful nation remembers.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News. If you've ever been up for orders, you know how much time you can spend on the phone trying to talk to your detailer. And for people on the West Coast or overseas, you have to stay up late or get up early just to get a chance to get through.
Well, detailers are answering the call from the fleet for more accessibility, and they're working late to help sailors around the globe get answers to detailing questions. Petty Officer Dave Smith explains how night detailing can help you get through.
A few weeks ago, we told you about new dates being set for the night detailing program. And as of last month, night detailing takes place 2 working days after new job requisitions come out. Well, now we're going to show you this program in action. It's 7 p.m., dark and quiet here outside of the Bureau of Naval Personnel. But inside, on the 3rd and 4th decks, detailers are busy answering phone calls.
Good evening, St. Chief Foes, may I help you?
Yes, well, my name is CTO 3 Simmons, and I need to...
Although it's 7 at night in D.C., here in Pearl Harbor, it's only 1 in the afternoon. Without the benefit of night detailing, Petty Officer Simmons would normally have to get up in the wee hours of the morning to make this call.
If you get up at 2 by noon, you're whipped every once in a while, and it just makes it more convenient for people to be able to do it at their lunch break, or after quarters, things like that.
Right now, you're considered a fourth quarter roller, all right, and we're not authorized to negotiate orders for fourth quarter roll due to the fiscal year constraints. However, what we can do tonight is go ahead and go through your record and kind of give you some ideas of what to expect.
USS Chilson gets underway soon, and Simmons wants to negotiate before they depart. And the beauty of it all is that he'll have that opportunity.
I'll try to call him back up, and hopefully next time they'll have a little bit, something a little bit more closer to what I would have liked.
And if he doesn't have an E-4 requisition, you know, he'll take a look at the E-5 recs and try to get it approved to put him in E-5 rec. So the CTO-3 may win big time in this deal.
So even though the negotiations haven't been finalized yet, Petty Officer Simmons didn't lose any sleep over it. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Dave Smith.
The next night detailing dates are scheduled for November 22nd and December 6th. You can check the back cover of the latest Link magazine for PRD windows and other night detailing information.
And if you're talking with your detailer about orders, you might want to consider a job that builds for the future. With the closing of recruit training commands in San Diego and Orlando, the only remaining RTC is, of course, Great Lakes.
As Petty Officer Ron Flanders tells us, while Northern Illinois may not be known for its warm climate, it shines as a duty assignment for top fleet sailors who want a job that makes an impact.
A new era has arrived at Recruit Training Command Great Lakes. The dreaded barber's chair that has had new Navy men quaking in their sneakers for decades now has an equal effect on Navy women who have commenced training here. That's right, Integrated companies are now a reality at Great Lakes, and they're too busy receiving state-of-the-art training in such areas as firefighting and seamanship to pay any attention to such trivial matters as gender.
It's not different. We're training sailors. We're not training females, we're not training males, we're training young people to be sailors.
The recruits in Company 341 will help make up the Navy of tomorrow. They are trained by two proven fleet sailors. Bill Edenbeck is a first-class bosun's mate with four Navy achievement medals. And Vivian Cousins is a hard-charging second-class operations specialist who has already served on three ships. Despite long hours training their recruits, both have their reasons for volunteering for the job.
Well, the hours are long, but it's a challenging billet, and that's what I was looking for, something that would present a real challenge, and it definitely does.
While I was out in the fleet, the product that I seen coming in, I really didn't like it. It wasn't up to, a lot of it wasn't up to my standards, so I figured the best way to help out was to go where it started to help out. Trying to do my best.
Doing their best to mold the Navy of the future are enlisted sailors, ranging from second-class petty officer all the way to master chief. After they've completed rigorous screening and training processes, they are handed their red ropes and a major responsibility along with them.
The sailors that come from our fleet to train at RTC are 4O sailors. They're the best the fleet has to offer. They are going to shape and mold the future of our Navy for many years to come right now.
Of course, satisfaction for a job well done sometimes isn't enough. For these top performers, the Navy throws in other benefits, including a $220 per month special duty pay, an extra uniform allowance to cover the costs of constant uniform upkeep, and even partial C credit. Plus, company commander duty can help you with advancements.
Well, the board members, being senior people, must know that pushing recruit companies has got to be a very arduous duty, even though it's considered shore duty. They know that if somebody's pushing companies, they're in the top percent of the Navy.
Of course, the true reward to the sailor and the Navy comes on that final day of boot camp, when the word recruit is removed and the title shipmate replaces it. Petty Officer Ron Flanders, Recruit Training Command, Great Lakes, Illinois.
You know, that looks like a great place for a sailor to get stationed if he or she wants to really move ahead in the Navy.
I think so. It's a very challenging job, takes a lot of hours, but it gives sailors an opportunity to teach skills to new recruits who will someday be running the Navy.
Well, Marines, too, have a similar opportunity. They can help teach skills needed throughout life, designed to help kids in danger of falling through the cracks. An ongoing program puts Marines into the local community to teach youngsters what it takes to be a young Marine.
Warm it up! Let's go! Hurry up!
It's a Thursday evening at 8th and I in Washington, D.C., and the Marines are getting ready for physical training and inspection. But these young Marines don't look like anything you'll see in the field. They're younger than most, and none are out of high school.
Like I said, we train them in the image of Marines, to be just a split image of Marines, okay? Tell them to iron their uniforms just like regular Marines do. Basically, I call them young Marines, and they are Marines, really.
Not everyone can be a young Marine. Kids between 8 and 18 must first go through boot camp, sacrificing one night a week for 13 weeks. They learn the basics, facing movements, confidence, and the young Marine code.
From this day forward,
I sincerely promise I will set an example for all of you to follow.
Honesty, fairness, courage, and respect are the traits of a young Marine, and leadership is how they learn them.
I learned leadership skills. I learned how to be able to control a large amount of people by setting a good example, using my best judgment in whatever I do.
By giving these young Marines a sense of responsibility, it improves their outlook on life as well.
I see a difference in her attitude, and she seems to take things a little more serious now. And she seems to be proud of her uniform and proud of the program, and she's always enthused about the activities that they do.
Because I've never been on a drill team before, and I didn't know I did that well, so I was proud of myself.
Every Thursday is a new adventure for the kids, but for the Marine volunteers, it's a growing friendship.
So little, but they look almost like Marines. I was almost fooled.
I know there was a 15-year-old that I talked to, and he had his entire Marine Corps career already planned out.
Definitely hardcore.
I know. Well, if you'd like to work as a volunteer or sign up your child for the Young Marines, call your local Reserve Training Center or the Marine Corps League, and they can give you all the specifics.
Now, the Marines are not only helping kids in the community, but also they're helping out on the battlefield.
Without maintenance teams like the First Force Service Support Group at Camp Pendleton, California, a lot of sailors and Marines wouldn't be able to get their jobs done. The Department of Defense recognized their hard work and named the first FSSG the best repairman in the military, operating forward from the sea. Last year, the Marines of the 1st Maintenance Battalion were the primary group to support Operation Restore Hope, deploying more than 300 Marines to Somalia. Their work during that deployment helped them win the Phoenix Award from DoD as the best repairman in all the services. The award was a nice payback for the Marines, who had worked hard all year round.
I'm very happy about it. I think it's a well-deserved award for Maintenance Battalion. I'm glad that our Colonel Ife put us in for the award.
During Operation Restore Hope, the battalion worked in a joint task force, fixing equipment from all services and many different countries. Figuring out how to properly fix some of that equipment was a big obstacle to overcome. But overcome it they did, and helped the readiness of all the services and countries involved, and prove their motto, "We do windows."
Think I can get them to come to my house and do my windows for me? They do a little everything?
No. No.
Guess not. Well, when we return, tugboat crews perform a vital mission around the fleet.
Stay with us.
Wayne Winfield and Ron Williams were two of the most heavily recruited high school kids in the country. Of course, it wasn't for their game. It was for their minds. And thanks to the Navy College Fund and the Montgomery GI Bill, they have a chance to really use them because they can earn up to $30,000 for college. So, even if the NBA isn't in their future,
I guess that's game.
A BA is. For more information, call 1-800-USA-NAVY.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News. When you think of the Navy, you probably think of mighty warships, you know, aircraft carriers, Aegis cruisers, submarines, but probably not tugboats.
Yeah, but those mighty warships couldn't even leave the pier without those tugboats. Petty Officer Tony Lopez found out it doesn't matter how big or small you are, it's what you do that counts.
Navy tugboats underway. They certainly give a port a traditional maritime feeling, and there are 5 Navy tugs here at Fleet Activities Yokosuka. Their mission, to serve the 7th Fleet.
Tying up to a ship or pulling a ship out, if you should mess up once, it could cost somebody their life.
Tug teams use several different line configurations called makeups, depending on the size of the ship they're moving and how many tugs are on the job. Basically, a tug crew consists of a tug master who drives the tug, a chief engineer, 3 line handlers, and 2 watchstanders. And each member of the crew is familiar with all positions on board their tug.
You gotta know everything about the tug. You have to know how to drive it, to stand the engine watches, to handle the lines. You know, I mean, if they gave ESWAS for tugs, you know, everybody would have one.
The tug master communicates to line handlers and other ship's pilots using bells and air horns.
When she rings one bell, it means to heave around, heave the, you know, move the caps in a certain direction to heave the line in. Like, another one is 2 bells to slack off.
And the horn is for, instead of using the radio, it's communicating with the pilot. When the pilot gives a command, she blows the horn a certain number of times to let the pilot know that she understands and she'll do it.
And doing a good number of things on a tug is different from larger ships.
Learning the diesel engines, because, one, I'm a machinist mate, so I'm steam turbines and stuff like that.
In a way, tugs seem like the little guy with something to prove. Of course, a tug and a good crew are worth their salt as they set to sea and welcome home the fleet. Petty Officer Tony Lopez, Yokosuka, Japan.
Sailors are well known for their participation in volunteer efforts, and this year is no different. Hundreds of servicemen and women participated in the United Way's 3rd annual Day of Caring. Petty Officer John Charlton has more.
Nearly 800 servicemen and women turned out for United Way's Day of Caring, helping thousands more in the Hampton Roads area. The event pairs volunteers with numerous nonprofit organizations, and sailors joined in a variety of projects.
While I'm painting, I'm thinking about, you know, that this dingy wall is all of a sudden just a little bit brighter for that lost mother and her child or whatever, and it just might brighten her day to know that somebody out there cares about her in just a little way.
Sailors from USS Yellowstone took part in several projects around town. Some worked at a food bank distributing supplies to nearly 300 charities, while others logged numerous hours giving the Haven Family Assistance Center a well-deserved facelift. Chief Cynthia Gasser and fellow shipmates saw the day as a chance to pay back the community.
The community does a lot for us, especially when we're deployed and our families are left behind. You know, there's a lot of community services available out there for their families that are left behind. And it's just an appreciation effort back and forth between the Navy and the civilian community.
And the hard work doesn't go unnoticed at Haven House.
I think they're great. They're usually hardworking. Some of the volunteers that we've had in the past have been single Navy people that have been stationed in this area and haven't had local family. It works great for them and for us.
This day of caring brought out many things: pride, community spirit, and compassion.
To me, it's like brings me back to the philosophy my father had, that the greatest monuments you leave in this life are the monuments you leave in the hearts of the people you touch.
For Navy and Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer John Charlton.
You know, it's great to see the sailors and Marines really getting out and getting to know their community.
That's right. And when you think of sharing holidays like Thanksgiving, you probably think of family, food, and helping those in need. But for many, Thanksgiving is just one day in a year. However, the Navy shares Thanksgiving with their communities all year round. It's the holiday season again, and sailors are helping out all over the world by sharing Thanksgiving. This program encourages sailors and their families to serve their community all year round.
Wherever a sailor has a home port or an area of duty, they can look around, search out what the needs are in that community.
Sailors have taken on many projects to help their local communities. In one example, a group of sailors turned an old warehouse into a shelter for the homeless in Philadelphia. But sailors help in other areas of the world also, like when a group of sailors visited Romanian orphans and brought supplies and smiles to their faces.
Well, I think the kinds of bridges we build with the civilians, not only of our own country, but of other countries, lend credence not only to the fact that the Navy is a power for peace, but it's a power for help.
Sharing Thanksgiving gives sailors a chance to help their community in a way that will be remembered all year round. Volunteering your time is a great way to help out the community. But if you don't know where to look, you can call your local Red Cross or Family Service Center. They can help people find programs that are dedicated to helping those in need.
Well, that's our show for this week. I'm Christiana Halsey.
And I'm Herb Josie. Before we leave you this week, take a look at the November issue of All Hands. It's hitting the fleet right now and focuses on how the surface Navy is operating forward from the sea. You'll find great photos and stories and even tips on how to prepare for your enlisted surface warfare specialist oral board.
And don't forget to call us with your comments on our show. Our Navy Marine Corps News feedback line is area code 202-433-6108, or you can call DSN at 288-6108. Just leave a message on the machine anytime, day or night. We do look forward to hearing from you.
And don't forget, we also have an email address if you'd like to send us a computer message. Here's where to send the email, and if you didn't have time to write it down, it's also in the weekly Nav News message. We'll leave you this week with another look at tugboat crews in Yokosuka, Japan. Have a great week.
matter where this ship goes, that will every chief petty officer in the Navy will say, that's my ship.
This is a great day for the Navy right here. I'm very proud to be here.
And come they did, by the thousands, chief petty officers, former chief petty officers, from all over the world. They came together at Little Creek Amphibious Base to see the ship named in their honor come to life. This day was for chiefs and by chiefs. The band, all chiefs. The color guard, all chiefs. Even the side boys, chiefs. Outside the commissioning tent, chiefs lined up to buy USS Chief souvenirs and mementos.
Take care of that fleet out there, I'll tell you.
And up and down the pier, chiefs got caught up in the emotion and camaraderie of this day.
This is the first one I have seen since 1946, and I had goosebumps when they commissioned it.
We're the backbone of the Navy, so the name ship means a lot to me.
And the day meant a lot for the crew, especially EN3 Randy Marquez, whose grandfather came to see the ship commissioned.
Because I know it'd mean a lot to him to be here, so that makes me happy that he's here.
I'm real proud. I'm real proud of all the men on that ship.
You see, his grandfather served on the original USS Chief back in World War II, and has plenty of stories to tell his grandson about sailing on a minesweeper.
Take advantage of all the schools, the training he can get.
This is truly a special and historic day for Chief Petty Officers, those who have served, those now serving, and those who will serve after us.
Some have suggested that the ship takes on the qualities of the crew or the sponsor. My hope is that she will take on the very best qualities of the Chief Petty Officer.
Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Mike Porter praised those qualities, which chiefs have used throughout the years to make other people successful, especially in his case.
My chief, George Everding. George, please stand so everyone here can applaud a chief petty officer who not only cared about his people, but a chief petty officer who went more than the extra mile to make a difference.
The CNO met his chief after the ceremony. This was the person who, years ago, got then PN1 Border to sign up for the Seaman to Admiral program, and you know the rest of the story. The minesweeper is small and has a small crew, but USS Chief will sail with something larger than the ship and crew, the spirit of all Chief Petty Officers in the Navy, past, present, and future. Over 1,000 Marines are providing external security for most of the Cuban migrant camps here in Guantanamo Bay.
Abajo.
The largest contributor of these caretakers, about 800, are from 1st Battalion, 2nd Marines out of Camp Lejeune.
Our mission is external security of the wire to make sure the migrants are safe from any danger of the wire, for example, them trying to go over the wire.
They not only patrol around the camps.
Rover 4 is guard check.
They also keep watch from guard towers.
What we do is we look for things like black marketing, little things being passed back and forth from one camp to another, and watching for migrants trying to escape.
A few migrants do escape. There are just not enough Marines to keep the tens of thousands of Cubans in the camps. Some are just trying to get back to Cuba without waiting for proper channels. They either climb down these cliffs and try to swim to Cuba, or they head for the hills.
What they do is break out the camps, and they try to find a road, one like this, or the high tops down here. Or they try to stay high so they can see if anybody's coming after them.
It's the job of Marines like these, members of an observation or listening post, that patrol and look for migrants that have walked away from their camps. They return most of the Cubans wandering these hills, but not all are caught.
What they do is they go across the ridge line over to the high top, and they try to get over and across. You see a fire out there, there's a little tower. That's the closest Cuban tower, right out here.
Marines tell me that the best security isn't patrolling around the camps, but it's getting together with the Cubans and participating in events like this.
Malafoy! I think they like it a lot. I think it gives them something more to do than they have in camp. And it's important for them to see that we care about them, because we do.
Siento muy bien, la verdad. No tenemos ningún tipo de problema entre los cubanos y los marines.
He says he feels very good about running with us. He doesn't have the Cubans and the Marines don't have any problems, and this is the best thing for them.
While running is probably the most popular activity between Cubans and Marines, they also play softball and basketball. These activities help bring Marines and migrants together to see each other as real people.
As you know, we deal with external security, and we don't see these people on the outside. Now, once we get together with them, we see how they are. We can communicate, in other words, and it becomes a better life for both of us. We understand them even more.
Besides sports, Marines are also helping out in other ways, like providing a wheelchair for this handicapped Cuban.
Just try it out.
And it gives you a good feeling inside that you're really, really helping people, and you get to see it hands-on. You know, you don't see it from just one point of view. You get to see it right up close, up front, and to see that your individual actions can help an individual person.
Marines, not just providing security, but showing the kind of caretakers they truly are. Petty Officer Bill Miles, Guantanamo Bay, Cuba.
This is one of dozens of camps in Gitmo that are temporary home to tens of thousands of Cuban and Haitian migrants. Within the camps are more than 2,000 children of all ages, children like 11-year-old Saley Diaz. In front of her is the concertina wire fence that separates her camp from the naval station. This is what Gitmo looked like to Saley and the other children. That all changed when a group of active duty Navy personnel stationed in Gitmo had an idea to bring these kids to the school playgrounds. It's called Operation Love the Children, and because of this program, Saley and hundreds of children in these camps are seeing a different Gitmo. Operation Love the Children is a volunteer program providing field trips to Cuban and Haitian children in Gitmo. Buses take the children and their camp chaperones to the elementary school playground 6 days a week. Love the Children volunteers greet the children at the school. The primary function of volunteers is to make sure the children are safe, their needs are taken care of, and they enjoy their afternoon at the playground. For the volunteers, the rest of the time is spent playing with the kids.
And that's good for them today, man, you know. I hope everything going like this, you know what I'm saying?
The volunteers come from base residents and personnel within the Joint Task Force. Although the program was designed for the children, for many volunteers, interacting with these kids helps them deal with their stressful jobs and separation from their own families.
Our dependents were taken off the base just a little over a month ago, and so we have a chance to come out and do something with children since ours are no longer here.
I feel that this is making a positive impact on the children because we're making a bad situation better.
These children have been through some very scary times over the past few months. Operation Love the Children allows them to get out of the camps and just be kids for a while. For the volunteers who come out, it's a chance to relax, show they care, and love the children. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Michael Dean Gold, Guantanamo Bay, Cuba.
Hey, come on. Pizza, pizza, pizza.
kid.
Resbala. Como resbala eso. Sí, 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 no puedo caminar. Ven, ven.
A few weeks ago, we told you about new dates being set for the night detailing program. And as of last month, night detailing takes place 2 working days after new job requisitions come out. Well, now we're going to show you this program in action. It's 7 p.m., dark and quiet here outside of the Bureau of Naval Personnel. But inside, on the 3rd and 4th decks, detailers are busy answering phone calls.
Good evening, St. Chief Foes, may I help you?
Yes, well, my name is CTO 3 Simmons, and I need to...
Although it's 7 at night in D.C., here in Pearl Harbor, it's only 1 in the afternoon. Without the benefit of night detailing, Petty Officer Simmons would normally have to get up in the wee hours of the morning to make this call.
If you get up at 2 by noon, you're whipped every once in a while, and it just makes it more convenient for people to be able to do it at their lunch break, or, you know, after quarters, things like that.
Right now, you're considered a fourth quarter roller, all right, and we're not authorized to negotiate orders for fourth quarter roll due to the fiscal year constraints. However, what we can do tonight is go ahead and go through your record and kind of give you some ideas of what to expect.
USS Chilson gets underway soon, and Simmons wants to negotiate before they depart. And the beauty of it all is that he'll have that opportunity.
I'll try to call him back up, and hopefully next time they'll have a little bit, something a little bit more closer to what I would have liked.
And if he doesn't have an E-4 requisition, you know, he'll take a look at the E-5 recs and try to get it approved to put him in an E-5 rec. So the CTO-3 may win big time in this deal.
So even though the negotiations haven't been finalized yet, Petty Officer Simmons didn't lose any sleep over it. Well, for Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Dave Smith.
A new era has arrived at Recruit Training Command, Great Lakes. The dreaded barber's chair that has had new Navy men quaking in their sneakers for decades now has an equal effect on Navy women who have commenced training here. That's right, integrated companies are now a reality at Great Lakes, and they're too busy receiving state-of-the-art training in such areas as firefighting and seamanship to pay any attention to such trivial matters as gender.
It's not different. We're training sailors. We're not training females, we're not training males, we're training young people to be sailors.
The recruits in Company 341 will help make up the Navy of tomorrow. They are trained by 2 proven fleet sailors. Bill Edenbeck is a first-class bosun's mate with 4 Navy achievement medals. And Vivian Cousins is a hard-charging second-class operations specialist who has already served on 3 ships. Despite long hours training their recruits, both have their reasons for volunteering for the job.
Well, the hours are long, but it's a challenging billet, and that's what I was looking for, something that would present a real challenge, and it definitely does.
While I was out in the fleet, the product that I seen coming in, I really didn't like it. It wasn't up to A lot of it wasn't up to my standards, so I figured the best way to help out was to go where it started to help out, trying to do my best.
Doing their best to mold the Navy of the future are enlisted sailors, ranging from second-class petty officer all the way to master chief. After they've completed rigorous screening and training processes, they are handed their red ropes and a major responsibility along with them.
The sailors that come from our fleet to train at RTC are 4-0 sailors. They're the best the fleet has to offer. They are going to shape and mold the future of our Navy for many years to come right now.
Of course, satisfaction for a job well done sometimes isn't enough. For these top performers, the Navy throws in other benefits, including a $220 per month special duty pay, an extra uniform allowance to cover the costs of constant uniform upkeep, and even partial sea credit. Plus, company commander duty can help you with advancements.
Well, the board members, being senior people, must know that push and recruit companies has got to be a very arduous duty, even though it's considered shore duty. They know that if somebody's pushing companies, they're in the top percent of the Navy.
Of course, the true reward to the sailor and the Navy comes on that final day of boot camp, when the word recruit is removed and the title shipmate replaces it. Petty Officer Ron Flanders, Recruit Training Command, Great Lakes, Illinois.
Evening at 8th and I in Washington, D.C., and the Marines are getting ready for physical training and inspection. But these young Marines don't look like anything you'll see in the field. They're younger than most, and none are out of high school.
Like I said, we train them in the image of Marines, to be just a splitting image of Marines, okay? Tell them to iron their uniforms just like regular Marines do. Basically, I call them young Marines, and they are Marines, really.
Not everyone can be a young Marine. Kids between 8 and 18 must first go through boot camp, sacrificing one night a week for 13 weeks. They learn the basics, facing movements, confidence, and the young Marine code.
From this day forward,
I sincerely promise I will set an example for all of you to follow.
Honesty, fairness, courage, and respect are the traits of a young Marine, and leadership is how they learn them.
I learned leadership skills. I learned how to be able to control a large amount of people by setting a good example, using my best judgment in whatever I do.
By giving these young Marines a sense of responsibility, it improves their outlook on life as well.
I see a difference in her attitude, and she seems to take things a little more serious now. And she seems to be proud of her uniform and proud of the program, and she's always enthused about the activities that they do.
Because I'd never been on a drill team before, and I didn't know I did that well, so I was proud of myself.
Every Thursday is a new adventure for the kids, but for the Marine volunteers, it's a growing friendship.
Navy tugboats underway. They certainly give a port a traditional maritime feeling, and there are five Navy tugs here at Fleet Activities Yokosuka. Their mission, to serve the 7th Fleet.
Tying up to a ship or pulling a ship out, if you should mess up once, it could cost somebody their life.
Tug teams use several different line configurations called makeups, depending on the size of the ship they're moving and how many tugs are on the job. Basically, a tug crew consists of a tug master who drives the tug, a chief engineer, three line handlers, and two watchstanders. And each member of the crew is familiar with all positions on board their tug.
You gotta know everything about the tug. You have to know how to drive it, to stand the engine watches, to handle the lines. You know, I mean, if they gave ESWAS for tugs, you know, everybody would have one.
The tug master communicates to line handlers and other ship's pilots using bells and air horns.
When she rings one bell, it means to heave around, heave the, you know, move the caps in a certain direction to heave the line in. Like, another one is two bells to slack off.
And the horn is for, instead of using the radio, it's communicating with the pilot. When the pilot gives a command, she blows the horn a certain number of times to let the pilot know that she understands and she'll do it.
And doing a good number of things on a tug is different from larger ships.
Learning the diesel engines, because, one, I'm a machinist mate, so I'm steam turbines and stuff like that.
In a way, tugs seem like the little guy with something to prove. Of course, a tug and a good crew are worth their salt as they set to sea and welcome home the fleet. Petty Officer Tony Lopez, Yokosuka, Japan.
comes in, before we start heaving around, don't worry, it'll straighten itself up. When he comes in, before we start heaving around,
all right, keep your around and turn.
Nearly 800 servicemen and women turned out for the United Way's Day of Caring, helping thousands more in the Hampton Roads area. The event pairs volunteers with numerous nonprofit organizations, and sailors joined in a variety of projects.
While I'm painting, I'm thinking about, you know, that this dingy wall is all of a sudden just a little bit brighter for that lost mother and her child or whatever, and it just might brighten her day to know that somebody out there cares about her. And it's a little way.
Sailors from USS Yellowstone took part in several projects around town. Some worked at a food bank distributing supplies to nearly 300 charities, while others logged numerous hours giving the Haven Family Assistance Center a well-deserved facelift. Chief Cynthia Gasser and fellow shipmates saw the day as a chance to pay back the community.
The community does a lot for us, especially when we're deployed and our families are left behind. You know, there's a lot of community services available out there for their families that are left behind. And it's just an appreciation effort back and forth between the Navy and the civilian community.
And the hard work doesn't go unnoticed at Haven House.
I think they're great. They're usually hardworking. Some of the volunteers that we've had in the past have been single Navy people that have been stationed in this area and haven't had local family. It works great for them and for us.
This day of caring brought out many things: pride, community spirit, and compassion.
To me, it's like brings me back to a philosophy my father had, that the greatest monuments you leave in this life are the monuments you leave in the hearts of the people you touch.
For Navy and Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer John Charlton.
It's the holiday season again, and sailors are helping out all over the world by sharing Thanksgiving. This program encourages sailors and their families to serve their community all year round.
Wherever a sailor has a home port or an area of duty, they'll look around, search out what the needs are in that community.
Sailors have taken on many projects to help their local communities. In one example, a group of sailors turned an old warehouse into a shelter for the homeless in Philadelphia. But sailors help in other areas of the world also, like when a group of sailors visited Romanian orphans and brought supplies and smiles to their faces.
Well, I think the kinds of bridges we build with the civilians, not only of our own country, but of other countries.